Hello and welcome to this session in which we will discuss the uncollectible accounts. This topic is covered in intermediate accounting as well as the CPA exam. Specifically in this session, we're going to be covering the direct write-off method. In the next session, we would look at the allowance method. Now, it's very important that you understand the direct write-off method in order to appreciate, to understand better the allowance method. Also, the direct write-off method could be tested on the CPA exam. And if not for anything, it's tested for tax purposes. That's the tax purpose method for uncollectible accounts. So it's very important that you understand this topic. Whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. I don't replace your CPA review course. I am a useful addition to your CPA review course. I provide you alternative explanation, alternative procedures. Your risk is one month of subscription. Your potential gain is passing the exam. Take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university doing on the CPA exam. I do have other course catalog, such as advanced accounting, taxation, governmental accounting, intermediate accounting, so on and so forth. My CPA supplemental courses are aligned with your CPA review course, such as Wiley, Roger, Gleam, Becker, so on and so forth. And I do have access. I give you access to all the AICPA released questions with detailed solution. Almost 1,500 CPA questions in addition to my own CPA questions. If you have not connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation, like this recording, share it with others, connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, and Reddit. So let's talk about uncollectibles account. Well, account receivable is created, are created as a result of a sale. So what happened at the beginning? You make a sale on credit. You take a risk. You sell someone on credit, and under the assumption they are going to pay you the money. In a perfect world, here are the journal entries that we need for account receivable. We debit account receivable for $100. Let's assume we sold Ryan $100 worth of merchandise. We credit sales revenue for $100. So we bill Ryan $100. At some point in the future, Ryan will pay his bill for $100, and we are done. We created an account for Ryan. Ryan paid the account, and what's left is debit cash, credit sales receivable. And this will be the end of the chapter for your receivable chapter. Well, that's not the case. You know that's not the case because in the prior recording, we dealt with sales returns and allowances, and we dealt with sales discount. Sometime Ryan is not happy with the product. They will, you know, return it. Sometime they may pay early. We might give them a discount. There is much more involved. But in a perfect world, this is what account receivable looks like. It's as simple as selling on account, receiving the money. In this recording, we need to discuss what happens when when customers don't pay the balance for whatever reason or reasons. Now, bear in mind, you as an individual, make sure to pay your balance. Otherwise, your credit will be hammered. It's a little bit different for businesses. Because you and the business, they might be two separate entities. The credit of the business might be hammered, but not your credit. Your credit is very valuable, okay? Don't not pay your bill. I'm not going to put too negative. Pay your bill, okay? Make sure you do that. Because if you don't pay your bill, your credit will be hammered. There are two methods to deal with this uncollectible accounts. There is the direct write-off method, which is not a gap method. And this is what we will discuss in this chapter, in this session, sorry. And there's the allowance method. The allowance method is gap method. I'm not going to say it's difficult, and I'm not going to say it's challenging. It's more involved, that's all, than the direct write-off method. So in this session, we would look at the direct write-off method. What is the direct write-off method? What is that method? Well, it's easy. You write off the account. You remove the receivable when the company determines the account is uncollectible. It's as simple as that. Simply put, the company decides they have a policy. After a year of trying to collect the money, if we can't, we write off the account based on certain criteria. That's it. Now, this method is used for tax purposes. For tax purposes, this method is acceptable. And it's important to know it's acceptable for tax purposes because at some point you need to learn about the difference between financial accounting and tax accounting. And this is going to be one of the differences. As I said, it's not GAAP. It's not accepted by GAAP for two reasons. One is the receivable is not stated at net realizable value. What's happened is this. GAAP says you might have $1 million of receivables, but you have to tell us how much you expect to sell. So let's assume you only expect to, how much you expect to collect. If you only expect to collect $950, you have to deduct what's called an allowance of $50. And this $950 is called net realizable value. In other words, this is how much you expect to receive, 950. Well, the allowance, the direct write-off method don't make this adjustment. So that's why it's not GAAP. Because GAAP says, tell us how much you're really going to collect, not how much you really sold. Because you can sell a lot on account. You can open your door, ask, tell everyone, I'm selling on credit. If you want to buy, pay me later and everyone will buy from you. That's not what matters. What matters is how much you can collect. That's one reason. Another reason why it's not GAAP, it violates the matching principle. And we're going to discuss this topic again in the next session. But simply put, the matching principle says when you make a sale in a particular year, if you make a sale on credit in year one, this is the sale on credit in year one, it has to be matched with the expense. What happened under the direct write-off method, assume you make a sale in year one, you may not write it off until year two. Why? Because you are going to wait until you determine that the account is incollectible. So the sale in year one, the expense in year two, that's a violation of the matching principle. The sale should take place in year one, and the expense should take place in year one. And we will see how the allowance method will fix this problem. I'm just explaining why the direct write-off method is not GAAP. The direct write-off method is accepted if the amount is immaterial. So if the amount is immaterial for certain companies, in other words, what is immaterial? They don't expect to have incollectibles, and if they have any incollectibles, it's a very small amount. When you're dealing with government, government always pay their bill. Let's assume the majority of your customers are government, the federal government. You're not going to have incollectibles. They're going to pay their bill, right? So it's not a big deal. But we will see in the next session how we can address those issues in the allowance method. Specifically, why not GAAP? Specifically, why those, how we would address them, fix that issue. So the best way to illustrate the direct write-off method is to work a simple example. It's as simple as that. You made a sale to Ryan for $100, debit account receivable, credit sales revenue. At the beginning, I said in a perfect world, what you would do is you debit after 30 days or 60 days, you debit cash for 100, you credit receivable Ryan for 100, and life is over. Okay, for the account receivable, not for us. Okay. Now, after repeated attempts, we made calls, mailing, emailing, we talked to Ryan in person, Ryan fails to pay the bill, okay? By June 1st, 2026, so a year later, that's the company. The company determines that Ryan's account is incollectible. Now, we don't tell Ryan, right? We keep trying to collect the money from Ryan, but that's it. From our purposes, it's useless to keep the receivable on the books. So what do? At that point, we will debit an expense called bad debt expense. Now remember this account, bad debt expense. Now when do we debit bad debt expense? We debit bad debt expense when we determine that the account for Ryan is incollectible. So this is when we did it. And the reason I'm emphasizing this, the reason I'm highlighting this account, because we're gonna see it again in the next session when we use the allowance. In the next session, the bad debt expense will be used under different circumstances. So we're gonna debit bad debt expense 100, credit account receivable for Ryan 100. We were hoping rather than bad debt expense, we were hoping that Ryan pays cash, but that's not gonna happen, okay? So now we wrote off the account, and that's it. We wrote off the account for Ryan, so if we have a T account for account receivable, notice we had initially $100 when we sold it, then we credit the account $100, account receivable is zero, life is over, we're not gonna sell Ryan anything on credit anymore. That's how it works. Now, let's assume Ryan sent a check August 5th for $100. So approximately a month later, June went by, July went by, August 5th, suddenly we received a check in the mail for $100. Excellent. We're going to take the check. We have two entries to make after we write off an account. So this is when we write off the account. This is write off. This is when we write off the account. And when we write off the account, we have an expense. Remember, I'm going to say this one more time. When we write off the account, we have an expense. In the next session, you're going to see something different. Okay, so under the direct write-off method, when we write off the account, that's when the expense takes place. That's not going to be the case under the allowance method. I'm just preparing you. Okay, so let's assume Ryan sent the check. The first thing we do is we need to reverse the write-off. So we need to reverse this entry. Reversing means do the opposite. Debit accounts receivable. Remember what we did. First, we had $100, then we write it off. Now we're going to put it back. So this is the third $100. We're going to put it back on the books. Then we're going to accept the cash. Then we're going to take it off again. Then we're going to credit Ryan's account after we receive the money. We received the money. So that's good. At the end of the day, Ryan paid his balance. It took us a little bit long. We wrote off the account. We reversed it. But that's as complicated as it gets for the direct write-off method. And this is all what you need to know. Then in the next session, I'm going to talk about the incollectible method, which will be a little bit different than the direct write-off method, which it's going to be a gap method. At the end of this recording, once again, I'm going to remind you, whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I can help you invest in your accounting career and your CPA exam. Take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. For a nominal investment, you can have access to resources that's going to help you pass the exam. Good luck. Study hard. Stay safe. The CPA exam is worth it.